is that the process of differentiation is a first stage of life process, okay? The big thing that we do in the first stage of life is differentiate. Realize ourselves as different from others, okay? And we develop by virtue of that a strong enough consciousness so that we can be effective in the world, and also so that we can also penetrate deeply into the unconscious. Now, I think many of you probably have heard this. Psychological insight isn't worth a damn. Have you heard that? Insight isn't worth anything in psychology. A lot of people say that. Well, I totally disagree with that, because you have to have insight in order to specify the work that you're going to do with the unconscious. And let's keep that in mind, that differentiation is also the development of very specific insight. And then the second leg of the journey is the fall into what I call union and superiority. And then out of that comes a new high, an integral high. All living things go through these processes. Yes. Communion with anything that is integral to your particular state of existence. For example, Thomas Berry, who writes this wonderful book, The Dream of the Earth, discusses the sun, for example, as differentiated. It's a very unique star. It's a very unique star. But it's also part of a larger communion, and that is the Milky Way galaxy. And it also has a very unique interiority, that is creativity, and that it is the source of the 100 plus elements that compose all of matter, including your body and mind. Yeah.
The term I almost interchangeably, not quite, double day. And
with a lot of other bodies.
With ecstasy, for example.
Oh, yes. Yes, yes, yes. We're going to be dealing with that. A first stage of life development is achieving something of a high. We move, you see, out of a very, very primitive makeup as children and state of consciousness into what we call a head consciousness. That's high. That's high metaphorically in the body. We need a strong head consciousness. Yes.
I need to break that body, because I see that if you stay with that high, the integration of the body, it forms itself into a revolution.
It becomes a monstrosity in itself. Head consciousness by itself is an addiction, and it becomes the addiction to perfection, and it becomes workaholism. Okay, work becomes workaholism. And there are dramatic examples of dreams that illustrate that process. And maybe you have some, and we want to bring them in tomorrow. Okay. All right. Now I suggest to you now, in the context of the above, that there is a large underlying reason why so many people in our culture are presently addicted. Why our entire culture, in its stifling, controlling behaviors, especially in its larger organizations, is an addicted culture. The reason is found in our overly developed mode of differentiation that characterizes a patriarchal culture in which polar differences are stressed, in which anyone who is too different than the norm is looked on with suspicion. For 5,000 years now, in the West particularly, we have been undergoing a first stage of life development, an outer, heady, information-laden, highly systematized existence, living mainly from the neck up and from the skin out, cut off from the body and its emotions and instincts, cut off from a deeper body politics, cut off from a deep ecology that looks underneath mere environmentalist strategies, to our human affinities with all of nature, cut off, therefore, from our total Earth community, cut off further from the interiority of everything, from the creative potentials of the Earth and of all of its living things. Put it in more human terms, our patriarchal masculine mentality has cut off from the deeper meaning of both feminine and childlike. Yet, as Ashley Montague has pointed out in his Growing Young, the one great purpose of the 20 billion year evolutionary story is to produce a higher creature, the human being, who is imminently the childlike adult. Okay? The childlike adult. When I think of AA and all of its offspring, I think immediately of the importance of the group as a recouping of an elemental, even primitive-like community of anonymous believers in the importance of confessing our shortcomings and of being vulnerable, of acknowledging our need for a healing spiritual power in the face of our personal helplessness and our need to help others find this healing spiritual power. Further, 12 steps that further and give structure to this process is at its core a creative process in which through our interiority, our looking inward, we ripen into mature, innovative human beings based on a co-creative living with God within and amongst us.
Okay, and it occurred to me too when I started to work with Zoya's book and Leonard's book that Zoya actually focuses more on community. He looks at the addictive process as an attempt on the part of young people to enter into what he calls the community of consumerism. Very interesting thesis. And when you look at Leonard, what she's looking at is interiority, that is creativity, the creative potential in our addictive process. Now, I don't think this is accidental that these two books have been written. And when I say that, then I'm immediately asserting the synchronistic aspect of this process that's occurring in this latter part of the 20th century. And that synchronicity says that all of us are in a very, very deep network with all living things and with one another. And I don't think it's an accident that you and I are here together tonight. Now, finally, I want to come down to my last point. And that is that I'm convinced that that there is an original addiction, as I said, underlying all these other addictions. And this came to me, this term original addiction, when I went to Minnesota last December to work with a group of 42 people, most of whom had alcoholic problems in their personal lives or in some member of their family. And the rest had codependent and workaholic problems. And practically all of them have codependent problems. Now, before that workshop, I received a dream from a woman who has had serious difficulties in her family, not just with mother and father, but also with her sisters. She's a very sensitive, introverted, feeling person, and most of her sibs were extroverted, sensitive, extroverted thinking. She was really a lost sheep among five children and a mother and a father. They did not understand this quiet, sensitive child. She has a dream, and here's how the dream goes. I'm captured by a very, very powerful man. And he takes me to his hiding place. And in that hiding place, he says, in effect, to me, you can be free if you recite correctly the first commandment of the Decalogue, of the Ten Commandments. And she thinks for a moment, and then she blurts out, first, honor thy father and thy mother. And his response is no, but it's a no, as she says, that resounded through the stars and the planets. In wave after wave, and she awoke in terror. Now, I consider that an extraordinary thing. First, I am the Lord thy God. Thou shalt shalt not have strange gods before. What are the strange gods? Who are the strange gods? Mama and Papa. Not, in this case, as representatives of God. There are positive addictions, you see, here also. There are very real codependencies in an infant. And always pointing to the essential codependency with God within. But here we're talking about a wounding, and therefore what I call a primary idolatry. And a primary idolatry is the original addiction. The subservience of the child to parents. This woman, when she was about 12, decided that she was absolutely and totally evil, and that the only way she was going to save herself is by being the servant, the absolute servant of mother and father, and of her brothers and sisters. And it's taken her a long time to drop that. And to begin to realize, you see, the other more essential, more fundamental aspect of eating addiction, and that is claiming her own power. Okay? Claiming her own power. Now, very quickly, look and see what this looks like in this picture here. The fourth commandment is right up here. This is where the parent is internalized. This area here, that we call the grandiose area, is the place from which we receive our societal norms. This is the place of what Freud calls the superego. Superego. This is the place of power. Okay? But secondary power. And we'll get further into that. First three commandments are right down here. The first commandment, I am the Lord thy God, thou shalt not have strange gods before him. Second, do not take the name of the Lord thy God in vain. Third, remember the Sabbath day. Okay, now, again, translating these into psychic reality, what have you got? First, the self is speaking, as if self were God, which indeed it is. It's a realization of the intimate connection that we have with God. First, I am the primary referent and source of your power. No one else. No one else is. Indeed, I can give the highest respect to mother and father because I am giving the highest respect first and foremost to myself. And I am not going to dishonor this that I am at the core of my being, my uniqueness, and my connection with all living things. Okay? Second commandment. The third commandment, I am going to give time to be present to my inner mysterious ground. And then by virtue of that, then I can deal with any authority. You see, the fourth commandment, when it's expanded, is always, and in the classical catechisms, you have a discussion here of one's loyalty to not just mother and father, but also to the state, also to the to any institution in the upper realm. And that's real. That's real. But if you see this hierarchy, if you will, is not honored, then you're going to have all kinds of addictive relationships with your spouse, with ideals, with institutions, you name it. You name it. With substances, with specific behaviors within yourself, such as resentment that can just eat us up. The addiction to perfection, I call all of this wholly exaggerated. Wholly exaggerated. All right. I want to conclude by sharing with you a poem I consider one of the greatest ever written. It Shakespeare is 29 songs. And I think it fits beautifully into this concern that we have. Let the love that it speaks of be the self, your inner first divine lover, and the healer of all addiction. And this is how it goes. When in disgrace with fortune and men's eyes, I alone beweep my outcast state, and trouble death heaven with my fruitless cries, and look upon myself, and curse my fate, wishing myself like to one more rich in hope, featured like him, like him with friends possessed, desiring this man's art from that man's skill, and what I most enjoy contented least. When myself almost despising, happily I think on thee, and then my state like the lark at the break of day arising, from sullen earth sings hymns at heaven's gate. For thy sweet love remembered such wealth brings, that then I scorn to change my state with kings. Okay, thank you very much, and let's take a break now, and then we'll come back and you can and ask questions. And then I also want to share with you an amplification of what it means to be in touch with psychic reality from a dream here, and also from a dream from a person I'm working with.